Hi, friends. Susan Blackwell from the Spark File here to let you know that the doors are open for the Spark File Illume, a 9-month group creativity coaching mastermind that invites you to be the chief creative officer and chief marketing officer of your creativity. But what does that mean? That means in 9 months in Illume, you will clarify and advance your big creative goals and learn how to effectively share your work with the world. Now, if you're listening to this and you're an experienced creative or an accomplished professional who seeks a space where it is safe to attempt something you've never tried before, or complete a big creative project, or take your work to the next level, and acquire the skills needed to share your creative work with the world, Illume might be right for you. We are calling in emotionally intelligent, high-functioning creatives who are ready to level up. You can find out more by going to thesparkfile.com/Illume, but do it now to find out if Illume is right for you and to save with early bird discounts. That's thesparkfile.com/Illume. Take a leap, take a risk, go to thesparkfile.com/Illume and join us for Illume.
The Spark File podcast may contain profanity and other adult content.
Please use your discretion.
When I bump into something that inspires me, I dump it in my Spark File.
Spark File.
Could be something that I want to make or how I want to be. I pump it in my Spark File.
Spark File.
I jump into my Spark.
Welcome to the Spark File, your one-stop wang doodle for creative inspiration.
I'm Laura Camion.
And I'm Susan Blackwell. If you're an OG listener, welcome back, Sparkler. If you're joining us for the first time, welcome. You may be asking yourself, what exactly is a Spark File? Where do I get one? What do I file in it? These are such good questions, and we do have answers.
We do. A Spark File is a place where you consistently collect all of your inspirations and all of your fascinations.
Here's the deal. We are makers who make all kinds of things.
If you're like us and you're making stuff all the time or want to be making stuff all the time, you know, the wellspring of inspiration can run a little dry.
So we're on the lookout for fresh ideas, images, and inspiration that spark our creativity and pique our curiosity, things that inspire us to get up off of our asses and make things like this very podcast.
Or a thoughtful extension of love delivered by courier across time and space.
Oh, that sounds amazing. Or a mini adventure that makes the day special and memorable.
Oh, every episode we're going to reach into the Spark File and exchange some sparks. And from time to time, we're going to talk to some folks who spark us too.
And if you're not careful, you just might have breakfast for dinner. So without further ado, let's open up the Spark File.
Camion. I don't know why I kind of yelled it today. The Spark File. Yeah,
I'll take Blackwell. It. I feel like there's things, I did not make a good list, but there's some things I wanted to talk to you about.
Oh, talk it.
On the Spark File. Number one, I've been meaning to tell you this for so long. You did that fantastic episode about the Astor Place riots.
Yes. Yes.
Is that the right name, or the Astor riots?
Some people, it's interchangeable.
Got it. So there is a podcast, the Bowery Boys podcast. Are you familiar?
Yes. I'm familiar with that podcast. I did not listen to that episode before I did mine, but I am aware.
They do a virtual guided tour that you can pop in your earbuds and you can take a walk around that neighborhood. And I think when we are back in the swing of things, that would be so much fun to do.
That's an affirmative from me. Holy shit. Copy that. Yes. I mean, I love even like the podcast, the Bowery Boys, is named after the Bowery Boys. You know what I mean? They're, what do you call that? Like when you're like totally dropped in, they are completely dropped in to the history of New York, I think.
Yeah. I listened to that when I was like gathering sparks for the mudlarking, because they did a great, they did a really, really good episode of that podcast. about the way that garbage has been collected and processed in New York City throughout.
No way.
Yes. It was so good. But one of the, you know, one of the things was how they started putting all of that garbage out in Dead Horse Bay and like just like putting a little topsoil over the top of it. And that's why all of that stuff
is still there.
That's right. There was something else I wanted to tell you. And because I didn't write it down, I don't remember what.
I thought of, well, I don't think this is the thing you were going to tell me, but I know something I wanted to tell you. So I haven't watched it yet and it may not have even launched yet, but it's in the press now. A new show on Netflix called Hollywood. And
yes,
it's that Scotty Bowers spark that you did.
One of the storylines in that. Yes.
The garage is. Yeah.
I just saw that last night. And it made me want to see what Ryan Murphy and Ian Brennan have taken and done with that. I was like,
it seems like he's taken some liberties with, you know, some of the facts of history, but who doesn't when you're writing, you know? Mm-hmm. But I believe that the garage is in there and that storyline is accurate. And Rock Hudson, I think, I think that storyline's accurate.
Oh, I look forward to dipping a toe into that. That
you're
wasn't
right
what
on
I was
going
to tell you. And likewise, Cams. I mean, you did predict this whole pandemic, but
that's crazy.
I'll see if I remember what I was going to tell you, and if I don't remember, then I'll tell you off mic or next week. How about
okay.
that?
Okay. All right. Deal. Jot it down.
I know better than to. I was like, I'll remember. There's two things I'm going to tell her. Clearly, Meryl. How about some sparkage?
Let's do some sparking it up. Let's do it. Yeah. I'm going to start from the jump.
Okay.
I'm not going to lie to you, Susan. I never do. I'm not going to start today.
Don't start now.
This week was a bit of a doozy, and I wasn't feeling super great when I sat down to write my spark. And
yeah,
that's just the truth. I think we're both committed to telling the truth on this podcast. And you know what I mean? Like, these are really trying times. And I know that we both like preach feeling our feelings, mm-hmm. and the fact that it's okay if sometimes you don't feel like being creative.
Yes.
And the truth is, I did not feel like it. I just didn't feel like it. So I don't have a spark. I'm kidding. I do have a spark. That's not. I realize like that's where it sounds like I'm going.
I didn't do my homework.
So off to you then. What do you got? but I think also that's the thing about deadlines. You know, we also talk a lot about that. They are a very useful tool to motivate you, to push you through, even when you're not feeling it.
Yes.
So when I sat down to write my spark, I thought about doing something that was like emotionally moving, maybe uplifting, because I felt like that's what I needed. Yeah,
yeah,
personally. But frankly, I did not trust that I would be able to like hold it together. You know, I don't know what the sound of a teardrop hitting a microphone is, but
I think we
might have
it on
been
this
on
podcast before
on this particular mic.
Yeah.
You know, so I was like, okay, let me just set that aside for a minute. Also, it's a lot of pressure, right? To be like, I'm in this moment and I need to lift myself up and I'm not feeling it.
I think this is so great, Camia. Like yes to all of it, because I think we're all going through, depending on the day of the week, going through some version of what you're describing.
Right. I felt that. And I was like, I think it's going to be okay just to say, here's where we're at today.
Yeah.
So I set aside the need, you know, to do anything in particular. And I just let my mind kind of wander on things that are comforting me these days. Mm. Little small comforts, large mm-hmm. comforts, mm-hmm. just like what's getting me through.
Yeah.
And I thought about the fact that I went to the mailbox a few days ago. Here come the tears.
Here we go.
And inside my mailbox was the kindest, loveliest handwritten letter from my dear friend Courtney.
Oh.
And Courtney is in Texas right now with her parents. She's working from there until things like
reopen in New York. And she has taken to creating little works of art in the form of handwritten letters. And on this particular note, she had painted with watercolors on stationery and let it dry and then wrote me this heartfelt note and mailed it off to me.
Oh my God, Courtney, that's gorgeous.
Courtney. Now, any day of the week, really, and in any situation, you know, Courtney, she's awesome and she can bring a smile to my face and make me feel like the most amazing person on earth. Like, she's incredible with a compliment. She's generous and free-flowing with her kindness, and I just treasure her.
That's beautiful.
But on this particular day, it was just beyond. You know, it was a much-needed virtual hug. It was a work of art, and it just touched my soul. And that got me thinking about a few things. The beauty of handwritten things, this lost art, you know, of this personal art form, and frankly, the glory of the U.S. postal system.
Amen.
So let us dig into what developed into my spark, an ode to the U.S. postal system, aka USPS.
I love this. I love everything about it. I love Courtney. But I do think this is phenomenal that you're like, this is where I'm at. This is what is truly, what truly moved me this week. I love this.
Thanks. Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah.
I appreciate that. And it's also all I could muster. Honestly, I was like, I got to go with... where is it flowing? You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Where's what's like, again, just small comforts. What's comforting me? So, so I followed this little thread. And first, I thought we could talk about handwritten things. And for some of our younger listeners, I apologize. I am going to go full grandma on this one. Full grandma. No excuses, no hiding it. So in the course of our lifetime, and when I say our, I mean Suze and I, but for some of our younger listeners, it was before your lifetime, we have seen the transition from handwritten everything to electronic everything.
Yes. Yeah.
You know, as a child, there were typewriters, but then computers. And I distinctly remember when the idea of email was coming around, there was a computer lab at college at Kansas State University, where you could make a special trip to go to send someone a note via this thing called email, and they might send you one back. And I guess you could just check in periodically at the computer lab to see if anyone sent you an email back. But I remember thinking very clearly, I don't know anyone who would even have, what do you call it, an email address? Email address? Yeah. What is it? Yeah. No, I'm not going to need that. Thank you so much. But no.
You are giving me such time machine right now. Like I am traveling back into my own history and I'm like, I remember the computer lab at school. I remember having to ask my college boyfriend to, I would either handwrite or type my papers. And then I'd be like, babe, I didn't know how to work a computer. So I'd be like, can you put this into the computer? And I also remember the first time somebody, and it was somebody named Aaron. So I was going into my junior year of college, was like, this is email. And I was like, what is it? Huh. And he was like, let's write an email to somebody. And I was like, who are we writing it to? And he was like, just somebody, I don't know. It's somebody whose email is on this, like some sort of a chat room thing. And I was like, okay, let's write an email. Hi, we are Susan and Aaron. We are writing to you. This is an email. It was that it's basic.
Sending a letter into space.
But it was like maybe to an a pen alien pal. Out there.
Yeah.
We didn't know. It like, wasn't, yeah.
There was that feeling of like, why would I do that? For what purpose? To whom? Like, why would I need that?
It seemed like a pen pal. Like on Big Blue Marble, that TV show when we were little, where you could get a pen pal from around the world. It seemed like that sort of thing. It was sort of like just like a shot in the dark pen pal but situation.
Far less personal. Like if you've ever seen, what is that Matthew Broderick games. Oh my gosh.
War Games.
War Games. War Games. Thank you.
Yeah.
The computer screen on War Games, if you've ever seen like that
Pong.
Movie.
It's full yes. Pong. Yes.
And these big chunky letters, and you're like, this is the most impersonal thing. I don't even know if a human wrote this or if yeah. it was a robot. Yeah. Right?
Anyway, thanks for the time machine ride,
Cam. Oh, you bet. You bet. At that time for me, my best friend from high school was a year younger than me. Hi, mm-hmm. Amy.
Hi, Amy.
And Amy Leeds. And when I left for college, bless her heart, she would write me these long, like four-page, yes. single-space, front and back, just exposés of what's happening in her senior year. And in my mind's eye, I can vividly see her handwriting on the page. It was super unique yes. and fun and very distinct. I could tell in a second, that's from Amy. Uh-huh. It makes me smile just thinking about it. And I don't know about you, but I felt like all through school, like we really took pride in our handwriting. Like for someone to say, like you have the cutest or coolest or most amazing, what have you, handwriting.
Beautiful, yes.
A major compliment.
Yeah.
Like she's not only like so nice and so fun, her handwriting is so cute.
Amazing. Yeah.
Amazing. So Amy had that. So during college, my mom and my grandma also wrote me letters from time to time. And of course, I couldn't help but notice like the difference in handwriting. Graham Cracker, as I called her, had perfect grandma handwriting, like yeah. this cursive. And it felt to me like it was from a certain era. Like you could distinctly tell, and I'm sure that people can now.
Yes, like when she learned how to do cursive.
Yeah, and when yeah. they learned in school, and yeah. hers was probably complimented and was like of her time, great handwriting. But I could tell, like it was like, oh, that's grandma handwriting. And then my mom's was really similar to Graham Cracker, but it felt a little bit younger than hers. So, but uh-huh. not like me and Amy's. So over the course of the years, as my mom's health declined, like you could see it in her handwriting as well.
Yeah.
And that's something that like to this day that just gave me very visceral feelings of sadness. Sure. You know, we yeah. could see the decline happening mm-hmm. with each letter like that she wrote, like me and my siblings would compare notes and we could see the decline in each letter until there were no more letters.
Yeah.
Also in college, I fell in love with a guy who was studying to be an architect.
Oh,
and
that's
he actually
hot.
Did become to me. Oh, totally. And yes, we'll talk offline.
I always thought that would be super hot, like to have yeah. a boyfriend or a partner who was like an architect.
Totally. He became an architect for reals. Yeah. And like I was going to say, totally very, very attractive person, but also like a lovely human being. And they had this architect thing going on too, which is really great.
Yeah, that is great.
But he had that block lettering style that's like so specific. It's just screams designer, you know.
Frickin' love. I wish, you know who has that? Our friend Michael Barres, actually, his handwriting is impeccable. And he does. I'm like, you look like you have spent your life writing blueprints.
I love that so much.
I love it.
I realized like, oh, of course I love it. My dad had that writing too.
Oh, is it because of his work? Yes, mm-hmm. yes, yes, yes.
And woodworker, like every design he sketched was a work of art, but then so was the lettering, like the way he wrote out dimensions and the description of it, all of it.
I can't tell you how much this, I love this. I really do. And when I just love beautiful handwriting. Mine has certainly declined since I type mostly now, I type into the computer.
Me too.
But I love it when I see it. I don't really want to put the time into work on my own, but I love it when I see it in other people.
Me too. And the reverse of that is sometimes I'm embarrassed when I like see something and that I've written and I'm like, oh, who wrote? Oh,
you. I think you still have such beautiful writing.
Oh, only when I really like try. If I'm just writing things, it's like it's a lazy hand now for sure.
Yeah. Yeah.
But every card that my dad wrote me over the years, like birthday cards and whatnot, I could immediately identify as my dad's writing, and it would just bring me warmth and happiness. And even now, like when I see little notes from Wes, sometimes like just like ran to the store, be right back. Mm-hmm. My heart still like skips a beat. Like he has this very singular, like loopy sort of writing, the way he makes his A's and the W in his name. Like it's sort of an inexplicable burst of joy over the tiny details in his handwriting.
But also now that we live in this time, I think it's pretty safe to say that unless someone is really putting some effort into it, we are not writing notes to each other as frequently as we once did. And so it is more rare when you see Wes's handwriting on a thing. Well, maybe you guys write cards to each other every day. I don't know. But when you see a note on the counter that says, ran to the store, be right back, there is a little like when it is written by hand, it's the same way when I was visiting. I remember visiting the Van Gogh Museum when I was in Amsterdam, and I was like, his hand touched that
surface.
It's the same thing with that little note saying, ran to the store, be right back. Like Wes's hand touched that surface. I don't mean to be too like sacred about everything, but
please, I'm doing a whole spark on it. It is sacred. I really do think so. It is what distinguishes that from, you know, reading an email, which anyone could have written or a robot could have written, but that's like, it's your signature stamp, you know, your person, part of you.
Every time Nathan goes on a trip, every time he has to travel for work or to see his family, every single time he sends a letter back that he's written.
Is so frickin' sweet.
It is sweet.
That is and so awesome.
Usually he beats the letter back.
Sure, but then it's fun to get it. Like that time lapse, I think, is also part of the joy of the postal system. And we'll talk about that a little bit.
Yeah.
You know, we're so used to instant gratification, but to know, to discover that someone was thinking about you a week ago and you discover it now, it still has the same little bit of joy in it that they thought to send you that note, you know?
I love it.
So everything that I've read up, you know, that I read about regarding like the transition from handwritten to electronic communication talks about the loss of soul. Like we just said, if you see something typed, like anyone could have written it, and you know on some intellectual level, you know who wrote it because there's a label on your phone who says who that message is from or your email box that tells you who typed the words. But it's something you know intellectually. But when you see the handwriting of someone that you know on a letter, like that they have sent, you don't just know it intellectually. You feel it viscerally, I think.
Yeah.
Like you know that they put themselves into this note. It's part of them. And I really wonder, like genuinely, not facetiously, and if you are one of our younger listeners and fans, I would welcome you writing us and telling us your thoughts on this. But I truly wonder if younger people will ever feel this difference as greatly as we feel it, just because they haven't lived in a time when everything was handwritten.
Yeah, I wouldn't think so. I don't think so.
I wouldn't
I think
so
you,
either.
Everybody but, has their normal, you know, and it's not, it's, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But did you know that cursive is not taught in schools anymore?
I did know that. And I was also surprised when I think I might have mentioned this on the podcast before. A friend of mine from Israel, I wrote something in cursive and I handed it to them, like some information, and they were like, oh, I don't read cursive.
That's exactly this is what I really wanted to talk about. I couldn't believe it. Like they stopped teaching cursive in 2013, I think, and they're being taught to read print lettering, of course, obviously. But the letters that my grandmother wrote me, if I shared them with my 9-year-old niece, it is very possible that she might literally not know how to read it.
Yeah.
Isn't that interesting? It will look like, you know, when we go back and we look at, even if you look at like census, if you've ever been on ancestry.com and you look at like the census reports where they show, you know, like stylistically, it can be hard to read.
Yeah.
Right.
I feel like we've talked about this on a prior episode, but listen, if we have, you let us know.
Yeah. I told you it's grandma today. So grandma forgets.
We're going full but grandma.
This is genuinely a spark for me because I feel like that is such a loss. And it's another thing that's like in our lifetime. It's one thing for us to like look at ancient scripts and be like, well, I'm going to need an interpreter because I can't read this. It's another for me to say, my niece can't read what my grandma wrote.
Yeah.
I like, it just breaks my heart in so many pieces. Just the idea of our grandparents' letters being like a foreign language that will need translation. So that gets me. Obviously, I'm passionate about it, especially if I've spoken about it before, but there's other losses as well. Like we often talk about the power of the process of handwriting on the page, you know. It helps us with visual recognition and retention of material. But there's also studies that suggest creatively, in particular, it can be really important because many, many sources said this, but including the BBC, brain imaging studies show that writing in cursive activates areas of the brain that don't participate when you're typing on a keyboard. So you're literally using more of your brain when you handwrite something.
Yeah. My writing teacher, Linda Berry, it was kind of a requirement in her writing class. That first draft was pencil on paper. Right. And she felt very strongly about all these things that you're talking about.
Yeah. Julia Cameron does too with morning pages. Everyone's first question is always like, can I type my morning pages? I mean, no one's going to stop you, but you're missing out on a whole aspect there. But there's also the loss of immediacy and time and place. On lithub.com, Megan Forbes writes this. In the work of art in the age of mechanical reproduction, Walter Benjamin considers how the modern capacity for reproduction affected original artworks or our perception of those originals. Even in the most perfect reproduction, one thing is lacking: the here and now of the work of art, its unique existence in a particular place. It's hard to say what constitutes the original in an email correspondence. Like, it exists in multiple forms, in drafts, in inboxes, in sent folders, on CCs and BCs, and so on and so forth. But the handwritten letter does have all the ingredients that make an original: a singular here and now, a unique existence in a particular place. Letters on paper bear the mark of history. They show the trace of touch in fingerprints and coffee stains, and countless readings render little scars in brittle paper unfolded and folded up again.
Love that.
And I just thought that was just really true. Like, there's life in the tangible. Like you said, Nathan touched this piece of paper, wrote on it, put it in the mail, and it's arrived now at your home for you to touch and feel.
It's also reminding me of, I have saved not all my correspondence that I've received from people, but significant pieces of correspondence. And I have letters from people who, stacks, like a collection of letters from people who are not with us any longer, and then friends that are still with us. And it's these sort of like little, yes, but also how nice to have that like relic, that artifact of that, you know, that person touched.
Yeah, but it's like a piece of them. That's why I said oof, because it is like a piece of them that they've left behind.
And depending on some of, we have such creative friends that some of those pieces are, there's drawings, there's, you know, there's coloring, there's all sorts of creativity. So there are these little works of, if not art, creativity.
That's right.
That's right.
In terms of letter writing in particular, there's another phenomenon there is a vulnerability in writing it. You likely think through what you're planning to say, consider your word choices a bit more carefully because you can't just delete and rewrite.
That's right.
And you're more conscious of your expression than, and when you mail it, if you've ever mailed something truly heartfelt, something that reveals your feelings or brings up tough subjects, you know that once you have mailed that letter, you have to sit in the vulnerability of it.
Yes.
There's no recalling it. There's no sending a quick little note immediately after saying, whoops, that was too much, or it was meant for someone else. You can't, once you've sent it, it is out there and it's a deliberate sending of something. And now you wait for a response.
Yeah.
Of course, in this day and age, the response might come via phone call or FaceTime or email when they get that letter. But until just only a short time ago in human history, sending that letter meant sending it by postal system, and it might take weeks for it to arrive at its destination and weeks for a response to make its way back to you. That is agony.
It's also, there's sort of that bliss of I don't know. I just think yes, but also the when it's like a friendlier sort of correspondence or even a loving correspondence, there is a bliss to it too, knowing that you're going to send that letter and that you're probably going to get a goodie back.
I always play this game, like when I'm watching period dramas, which I love, so I don't, you know, it's not a criticism, but I'm like, oh, they sent that letter out. That took a month to get there. And this letter that they've received back as though it's like 2 days from now didn't happen. Because they had to, you know, those are the moments that I think about real vulnerability. If you are putting something in a letter that is truly like,
yeah,
here are my feelings and I don't know how you're going to feel about it. I will wait anxiously until you reply. So this leads me to the postal system. I'm sure that you have seen in the news recently that the United States postal system is in a little bit of trouble.
Yeah.
And our president isn't so inclined to help them survive. I will leave politics out of it. But before we scrap the whole system that made letter writing possible, I do think we should take just a momentary look back in appreciation for that very system that brought Courtney's much-needed letter from her home in Texas to my doorstep in Florida during a pandemic. The U.S. postal system has been around since 1775. Now I'm going to forget. That is the 1800s.
1800s.
It's not the 1800s. It's the 18th century. So if you take anything away, it's that.
It's the 18th century.
That's the most important thing to be said today.
I am so stupid when it comes to that. Sorry. You were saying.
No. Okay. So it has been around since 1775, thanks to the work of the very first postmaster general. Do you know who it was?
It's going to be somebody famous, right?
It's going to be someone you know. It's going to be a name you know. I'm going to tell you, it was Benjamin Franklin.
Oh, Benjamin Franklin.
Benjamin Franklin, damn it, if he's just one of those people who makes me wonder, what have I been doing with my time on this earth? Every time you turn around, you're like, he did that too?
Benjamin Franklin is great evidence to be like, don't waste time on social media.
Don't
like,
waste time on social media. You could be starting, you know, a postal system.
He famously said that. Don't waste time on social media.
Oh, amazing. But during the early, really early years when our country was just a bunch of colonies, most of the mail wasn't even between people here in America. It was between someone here and the people they left behind in Britain.
Talk about months, yeah.
Yeah, so almost all of the mail in the 1600s and early 1700s was to and from, like, across an ocean. And when it arrived here, it would likely just be left in a tavern or an inn, and you could pop in and see if there were any letters for you.
But, wow.
Yeah. But when we became an official country, there were 75 postal offices by that point. Now there's over 40,000. And at first, because our founding fathers believed that newspapers were essential to forming a nation so that people could read what was happening politically. Newspaper delivery was free. So that, like, because they prioritized that, this mail system was essential to them and getting that figured out.
Yeah.
So newspaper delivery was free. Eventually it cost a little bit, but just a tiny bit compared to sending letters. It used to be that you had to pay for the distance that the letter was going to travel. Kind of like long distance phone calls. Do you remember that?
Oh, so it,
I totally warned you fully, Granny, today.
Full grandma.
Long distance phone calls.
That's crazy. So you had to pay
more.
If you were like, this is going overseas, I guess that's still true. You pay more if it's going overseas. But if it was like, this is going either to Connecticut or to California, which probably didn't exist yet, you had to pay more.
No, they did. They did. And the first thing they did was up and down the coast. So you actually could, you know, to Massachusetts or to Florida, but you were going to pay more for that, you know?
Mm-hmm.
But eventually, they made a universal stamp rate that made it more possible for regular people to engage in correspondence with loved ones. In fact, according to Winifred Gallagher, the author of How the Post Office Created America, the
great name.
I know, right? I was going to say the same thing, but here's another great name coming up. It's the name of the first cheap adhesive prepaid stamp. It was called the Penny Black.
Oh,
the Penny Black was named for its price, penny, and its sober depiction of a 15-year-old Queen Victoria. It was issued in Britain in May of 1840, and then soon after, all other, you know, countries that had a postal system followed suit with this little stamp. Mm.
The Penny Black, it would be a great name for a band.
Yes, the Penny Black is amazing.
Yes, love that.
And you
know what the first
image.
Album cover is going to look like.
Yes, that's right.
The t-shirts, the merch. Yes.
Come on. So according to history.com, the USPS delivers 212 billion pieces of mail each year to over 144 million homes and businesses. They are our nation's largest civilian employer with over 700,000 career workers. And as we all know,
God,
that's a lot, right? They pride themselves on getting the mail delivered, rain or shine, using everything from planes to mules. They do it. They deliver
still?
It.
Mules.
Yeah, in certain places, because they also, Puerto Rico, Guam, you know, territories.
Oh,
and
yes. Yes, of course.
So they do it. There's probably places in Hawaii that need, that they might use a mule.
I want to go ahead and say on the record right now, I freaking love the USPS.
Yay!
I always have. I love them. Love our mail carrier. Like, carriers, I should say. And during this, like, cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs time of the pandemic, we have been treating them and tipping them and doing everything we can thank them, because they are, what would we do without them right now?
What would we do? And you'd have to pay a fortune and go out of your way to find a location to mail something from. Today, I sent a belated, it's going to be late, but Mother's Day card to Wes's mom, and I just walked out to my mailbox and put it there. I didn't have to go
anywhere.
It's
amazing. Yeah. It is amazing that that system exists, and it makes me, I guess we're not getting political except a little bit, it makes me insane, the thought that that would be jeopardized in some way.
Yeah, me too. Me too. Without getting political, there it is. Me too. It
but
makes me insane.
But I guess we've gotten political. Now, I know that it's needed. I mean, when I go into, I love our local post office, but when I go into, like, when you go into the post office, the big one that's by Penn Station in New York City, it is this big, grand building.
Majestic.
Needs some work, though. It needs some work. And
sure.
That's true of a lot of post offices, that the system, I feel like, needs some TLC. It doesn't need to be dismantled.
It does. But,
you know, it doesn't have the money it once had.
Right.
You know, there's a lot of issues there, but I think we need to rally and say we want to have this system. We need to have this system. As individuals, it benefits us to have this system.
Yeah.
Yeah. So more on that to come, but let's rally for the USPS.
Boo, 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 boo.
What? We're the coolest. Are we not coolest?
Ba, 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 ba,
hey, what do you stand
USPS.
For?
USPS.
We stand for the post office.
Mail.
Yeah. oh my God. So, country pride aside, the United States is not the first to have a postal system. That's kind of obvious, but sometimes we forget. According to ThoughtCo.com, the first documented use of a postal system, state-sponsored designated couriers who were trusted to transport messages, Egypt, 2400 BC. 2400 BC.
Get
used by
Egypt
pharaohs.
Egypt had, they had some advancements. I mean, they also, you know, there was slave labor and things that aren't fantastic, but man, did they figure some stuff out. And it
they
sounds
did.
Like postal service was one of them.
Yes. In
just
fact,
for pharaohs?
Earliest, I'm not sure. That's all I read about. So I did not read like that the average citizen could, you know, send something in the mail.
But somebody could.
Someone could. The earliest surviving piece of mail is also Egyptian.
What?
And it dates back to 255 BC.
What?
255 BC is
what?
I'll post a picture of it if I can get
what
a
is it? Do
picture.
They know what it says or what it communicates?
They might know, but I don't know.
they don't
read have
Egyptian.
That information. Yeah. But they're not the only ones. Many other civilizations that we've learned about had postal systems too. The Han Dynasty in China, the Islamic Empire in Arabia, the Inca Empire in Peru, all of them, postal systems. So sometimes I think about the fact that many, many times in history, people sent letters that they didn't know would have a resounding influence on history. Like, can you imagine, like, sometimes I try to wrap my brain around it, but, like, could you imagine years from now anyone finding an email that you wrote and culling it for information, for significance, you know? It's hard to imagine because when it's a handwritten letter, you can, like, experts can see when the person's under duress or, you can analyze the paper itself. Like there's a lot of information that can be gleaned from it, but not so much with email. But for some people, like they must realize at a certain point in their careers or in their lives that their letters would be historical evidence. And
so there's
no such thing as like a casual note for them.
Oh, that's right.
You know, I think that in Hamilton, the song History Has Its Eyes on You is so effective. For me, it was impactful for that reason because it was that moment of realizing like all of this is going to be analyzed, criticized, and into the history book. But so few of us have ever or will ever experience that type of pressure or have our pen wield that much power. But certainly there are people whose letters have helped us piece together like what really happened in history or letters that changed the course of history altogether. Mm. Let me tell you a couple examples of those.
Mm-hmm.
According to Michael Burlingame, historian and Lincoln scholar, Abraham Lincoln wrote 5 public letters that by bolstering Northern morale, people believe helped the Union win the Civil War, thus outlawing slavery, preserving national unity.
And in 5 letters.
In 5 letters. Arguably, the best one was addressed to Albert Hodges, dated April 4, 1864, in which he said, "I am naturally anti-slavery. If slavery is not wrong, nothing is wrong." And he essentially like vindicated this idea of government of the people, by the people, and for the people in these 5 letters, like really boosted morale at a moment when the Northern Army really needed, I guess, probably a good reminder of like, what the hell are we doing this for? This
Isn't
is why we're doing
amazing?
It.
Amazing.
This is why. Yeah.
The power of the pen.
The power of the pen. And according to Claiborne Carson, who is the founding director of the Martin Luther King Jr. Research and Education Institute, Martin Luther King Jr.'s letter from Birmingham jail was apparently, I didn't know this, it was not noticed very much in April 1963 when his colleagues in the civil rights movement stitched it together from the fragments that he had drafted in his cell. Major civil rights legislation was not then on President JFK's agenda, but the letter has gained recognition as the 20th century's most influential essay on civil disobedience. This is the letter that includes statements from Martin Luther King, such as, "Injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere," and, "We will have to repent in this generation, not merely for the hateful words and actions of the bad people, but for the appalling silence of the good people." Whoa. This letter is, it is incredible. Incredible. So letters, you know, they can make a difference, like on an enormous, enormous scale.
Yeah, change the course of history.
Creatively, yes, they can. Creatively, what has been made and what can be made of all of this? First of all, many a plot has hinged on a letter or a message arriving on time and without being seen by others. Romeo and Juliet, perhaps.
Yes.
In fact, in recent times, the prevalence of like cell phones and the ease of getting messages to people in a moment's notice has actually provided a new challenge for writers who can't rely yes. on like time and distance getting in the way. Right?
Yes.
So that's interesting. In Hamilton, we see Eliza burning the letters to and from her husband, knowing that that scandal would become his legacy if she did not destroy their communication about it.
Yes.
But she certainly was not the only person to supposedly destroy letters. According to the Los Angeles Review of Books, in the decade following Emily Dickinson's death, most of her correspondence went up in flames.
What?
Lavinia Dickinson, the poet's sister and companion, followed Emily's directives and burned letters that the poet had received. And a few copies of Dickinson's.
Oh, shit.
I know, right? You're just like, what is, fuck, what are we not seeing? What are we
missing?
Oh, shit,
Lavinia. Shit.
So a few of her letters survived, but many that did were the victims of what they called scissored deletions. Also, possibly a band name, Scissored Deletions. words and phrases that were delicately but deliberately sliced and cut out of the text.
Oh, man.
So they know that her sister and probably her brother, Austin Dickinson, were the most likely culprits of, you know, doing that. And they probably sought to either censor or protect. I'm sure they thought they were protecting their sister, but we'll never know exactly what was taken. Like, what did those little hole-ridden letters contain?
Wow.
Yeah. A.R. Gurney wrote Love Letters, which is a play that literally is letters written back and forth by lovers over the span of decades. It's so effective and moving, as like you hear what's on the page, but you use your imagination to fill in the empty spaces. I find it to be surprisingly effective.
I have never seen it, but it's a great piece for, typically it's done, isn't it done by sort of like older actors?
Yeah. And they don't even share, like you don't see them physically together. They're in two different locations. Actually, that's a good one for someone to do now in this, as everyone's doing online.
That's a good pandemic spark. Yeah.
That's a great one because they're in two different locations and they're writing letters and reading the letters back from, you know, and years go by in between. But yeah, it's surprisingly effective. Jane Austen and many, 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 many other writers, just citing a few examples here, but Jane Austen used letters. I think Pride and Prejudice is a good example of like a plot device to
to not only further the plot, but to reveal the character points of view. Like, you might get a letter from someone. And that reminds me that, like, if you are working out a character in your own work, writing a letter from your character's point of view is just a great exercise to hear how they would tell the story. Like, what they believe to be true at any given moment? Mm-hmm. You don't even have to leave it in your work. You can make that choice, of course, but it can be a great tool just for you to get the clarity on your story and your characters. So those are some, you know, obviously things that have been utilized in this artistically and creatively and historically. But in this moment, of course, you can also just sit down to write a thoughtful letter to someone that you care about. You can make it a work of art with watercolors or doodles if you feel inspired, like my friend Courtney did, or some of your friends, Susan. Yeah. Or you can just put words on the page, words from your heart, words that express your care, your gratitude, your joy of being alive, whatever you feel, whatever you feel. And perhaps they may not change the course of history, but I can tell you from experience this week, they are guaranteed to change the course of a day or a week for someone that you love.
Oh, I love that. That is gorgeous. And it makes me want to practice my penmanship, even though a minute ago I said I don't want to. It does make me want to get better at it.
Yeah. Yeah.
And also, we were just talking yesterday about it was so foggy where we were. And, you know, we spend these long quarantine days upon days upon days upon days upon days in the house, which I actually enjoy. But I was reminded of the movie The Others, and there's a really good plot point in The Others where Nicole Kidman's character takes a letter out to the foggy mailbox and puts it in. And then like it's 2 weeks later, a week later, she goes back out and she's like, why hasn't the letter gone out? And I was like, no spoilers, but that Dangerous Liaisons, it's in so much.
In Little Women, the letter, she goes back to get the letter and remove it from a mailbox.
Yeah.
And when I think about like those stories, I also think about this, that is just not true for any of us. If you've lived a life of any privilege, you have had access to pen and paper probably your whole life. But we, and I know that's not true for everyone, but if you have any amount of privilege, you most likely have pen and paper. And when you watch these period pieces and you realize that it was not a given that there was paper,
right?
It was not a given that you had an inkwell and a pen. If you had a desire to write, it was time consuming to dip that scroll, spread that ink on the page. It was difficult to do. There were barriers to entry to, like, you know, a 3-page letter is a pretty big investment of time and resources to have, you know, paper, pen, and time to do it. And I just think about, like, we just take that for granted that, of course, if I want to write a letter, I can, and it won't take me that much time, and I'll have what I need to do it. But always the case.
That reminds me of, there's a book, and I can't remember the title of it. It might be Where the Red Fern Grows. It might be a different book. And I know that that author, whoever wrote it, it was based on their own childhood. And they lived very remotely, very rural, and they didn't always have something to write with and something to write on, and they would use tree bark.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. When they were little, to capture those thoughts, because like you said, it's not always a given. It may feel like a given now, depending on how you grew up, but it isn't. And I just love that. There, you know,
just something to think about.
Your creativity will find a way.
That's right. That's right. And as long as you have the United States Postal System, they'll help you spread the word.
Oh, I love that, Camion. Thank you.
Thanks.
That was a good spark. How are you feeling now? You sound different. You sound like a different person.
I got that spark out. I shared it. There's so much truth in just telling it like it is. Like, this is how I felt when I sat down to write. This is the thread that I pulled on. And literally a thread pulled me out. You know what I mean?
Aww.
By just grasping on it and following it.
Yeah.
And I don't know, sometimes there are, in those moments of darkness, it's good to remember all it takes is a thread, if you can find one.
Thread and a deadline, baby.
Thread and a deadline. My God.
A spark and a deadline.
Tell me about your spark.
Well, first, let's just take a little break. Here we go.
The spark button!
And we're back. Camian, I got a little spark for you.
I want to hear it.
The title of my spark is Kittens on a Blanket.
Oh. Come my on. Spark,
that's the title of my spark. It's Kittens on a Blanket, whether you like it or not, Camian.
I like it a lot. A and it's too cute.
It's too it cute for cute. A podcast that has a, this podcast may include adult content, profanity. Please use your discretion.
It's perfect for grandmas, spark, though.
That's right. This should be a grandma episode. It kind of might be.
We might need to have like a new, like a trigger warning. Like it's a granny warning.
We're taking it back. My spark this week comes straight out of my life. As I said last episode, we little introverts are having a pretty peaceful quarantine. Yeah. We're growing our own vegetables. They're really taking off. We're cooking every meal at home. We're building fires in the fireplace. We're working very hard. We're enjoying life. And as it comes up, we're processing our fear and our upset and our loss and our pains and our joys sometimes. So, but all in all, I have to say we're doing pretty well. But we were having a conversation about what we are missing during Q times. And so here's something that I have been missing. One of our favorite dates was to get up early on a Saturday morning and take a long drive into the neighboring state. And we had this loop that we like that includes a thrift store that I like and some other stores and a good grocery store. But one of the first stops is always an 11 a.m. visit to Shake Shack.
Exactly 11 a.m.
We try to get there soon after they open because we would be one of the first ones there and there's never a line. And if you haven't heard of Shake Shack before, if you've never been to Shake Shack before, it is a restaurant. It's fast food. It is so fucking good. It's just simple. It's delicious. It's very pleasing to me visually. It's like hamburgers and hot dogs and mushroom burgers and fries and shakes. And, but because it's so good, there's usually a line. And if you're in New York City, there are certain locations that are bizonkers. And I have a general guideline in life that, which is I don't stand in lines for much of anything unless it's food. Like, do you know what I mean? Like I would
never.
It's not
a quarantine rule. It's just a rule in life.
No, it's a life rule. Like I don't. I mean, I'll stand in line now for the grocery store, but I won't stand in line to get into a club or like, please, you have got to go fuck yourself. But if you're a burger person, this food, Shake Shack food is kind of worth standing in line. So back to our Saturday morning date. We would each get a delicious Shack burger, two orders of fries, two bubble waters, seltzers, club sodas, whatever you want to call them. We'd always get Shack sauce, the whole deal. All of it for under $20. So, yeah, so that's what we miss. We miss our little Saturday date.
Yeah.
And while technically we cannot, I mean, we could drive to Shake Shack and get takeout. We're playing it. Everybody gets to do quarantine the way they want to do it, but we're playing it super safe when it comes to driving when we don't need to contact with others outside of our little quarantine cohort. So who knows when it will be safe to go out and be out and have that little date again. But then it occurred to me, what if we figured out a way to bring Shake Shack to our house?
Yeah.
So I went online. I watched several videos about how to make a great Shack burger or smash burger, as they are sometimes called, what ingredients I would need, how to approximate their little secret sauce. And like all COVID times cooking, I had to do some substitutions, but I did it. And I also wanted to make really good restaurant style French fries, real French fries, which I have never done before. So again, I watched several videos. I learned how you have to cut the potatoes, Camion, and then you soak the potatoes, and then you dry the potatoes, and then you fry the potatoes, then you drain the potatoes, and then you turn up the heat on the oil and you fry them again. And Camion, I did it.
You did it? Oh my God.
good.
I freaking did it.
Were they delicious? And did you salt them? I need to know about the salt. Were they salty?
There was so much salting that happened that this, so this was last night and I woke up this morning and I was like, I have eaten too much salt. I feel Agua. Like my eyes are just like, rah, rah. Yeah. So while it wasn't the same as going to Shake Shack and having someone make you that awesome meal for two people for under $20 in less than 5 minutes, it was pretty freaking great. We totally overate. I don't think I will make French fries at home again for about 72 reasons, including that they take a very long time and all of that salty fried food is terrible for you. But yes, it was fun to have that adventure one time.
There under your own roof.
That's right. But all of this inspired me further. What else can we do to make this time special? Mm. What other memories can we make so that when we look back on these queue times, we'll be like, remember when we did so-and-so during the pandemic? That was good times. So that is what my spark is all about today. If we are in decent health and we have the capacity, what can we do to make these times special and memorable and fun? And I just want to say right now, there is a giant bird that just flew past my window. I love you, giant bird.
Giant birds, and I love when you tell me about them. Suze, can I just tell you there was a fish that landed in our driveway yesterday?
Shut.
And it's from giant birds pulling them out of the lake and dropping them. Or fighting over them, and they fall. And then once they've fallen into like human territory, they don't want to get them.
How far is the lake from your place?
It's down the street. It's like,
so they literally like, they do that thing where they dive bomb, they scoop them up in their talons, they get up there and either they're like, wah, 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 and they lose their grasp or they're fighting over it. And then it drops from the sky.
That's right. But we've seen birds where like, first of all, they'll fly by and we're like, ooh, someone's got a snack. You know, sometimes it's like a little fish they've gotten. Sometimes it's a snake.
Somebody got a fish fillet. Yeah,
someone's having a good dinner. But then you might see even midair another bird come up and be like, I want that snack.
Give me that snake.
Yes.
I want that snake snack. I want that Shake Shack. Yeah,
but the first time it happened to me in Florida, I was home alone and a fish hit the roof and it flip-flopped. I heard it. I was sitting outside.
Oh my God.
Hit the roof and I heard it like flip-flop.
Didn't know what had happened to it.
Honestly. Oh my God. It landed on like we have a pool and there's a pool screen over it. So it like rolled down the roof and landed half on the roof and half on the screen. So I could see it. And I couldn't wrap my brain around how a fish fell from the sky because we had just moved here. And I was like,
what the actual fuck
did that happen? And now I'm much older and much wiser.
Grams has seen a lot in her day.
But I love your big birds. That's what
I love.
All
them too.
That Hi, is big to bird. Say I love your big birds.
I love yours, and I love that we get the privilege of seeing those big birds. When I see them, if I've been staring at a Zoom conference all day, my heart just like takes flight.
Yes.
Thank you, big birds. You're the best. Yes. So more memorable times, more fun times. Here's another one. This is a healthy antidote to our little at-home Shake Shack heart attack adventure. My friend Deborah and her family love Disney. They love Disney. They are Diz nerds. And they were supposed to do a Disney 5K this April. Aww. In Florida. Yeah. It was going to be Deborah's family. She's got twin girls, plus her mom, Naomi, and her stepdad, Buddy. They love Disney. They were all looking forward to it. And then after the race, the 5K, there's the flower and garden show that her parents, Naomi and Buddy, love to attend. But obviously, none of that happened. So a little backstory. Buddy, her stepdad, 88 years old, and he has been in recovery from heart surgery, which was about a year and some change ago. He has taken his recovery super seriously. He has modified his diet. He walks every day for an hour, and he's been doing amazing with that. So even though Disney had to close the parks, Disney still hosted a virtual 5K. So Deborah had an idea and she registered herself and Buddy and her cousin Kimberly.
Oh.
And yes, Disney issued them racing bibs that they could wear.
Uh-huh.
And they coordinated from separate locations. They coordinated what date and time they were going to do their 5K. And in the days leading, yes, in the days leading up to it, Buddy said he felt like he was training for a specific event that was bigger than him, and that broke the tedium of his normal walk, which again, he was super committed to, but he was like, you know, it gets boring. So the day of their race, which was last Sunday, they held a countdown. And then at 3 p.m., each of the racers began walking their own path in their own location. Mm-hmm. And the rest of the family was their cheer squad, just like they would be if their loved ones were running a traditional 5K. And each of the racers and a member of the cheer squad had a phone, and they were all communicating with each other via a group chat. And, you know, they were texting each other and sending videos and stuff like that.
I love it.
Yep. So the cheer squad was sending them videos and cheering each other on. So at Disney, if you're doing a marathon or you're doing a 5K, they have characters along the course that cheer you on. There's water stations. There's, you know, like the full Disney magic support. So my friend Deborah pretended that she was doing her 5K through the Disney park, and along her route, this is so sweet, along her route, she saw a rabbit, and she took a picture of the rabbit and she sent it to the group text and said, "Look, it's Thumper." And then she took a picture of three little spring flowers along the way and sent it to the group with the caption, "The flower and garden show isn't what it used to be." Just like cracking each other up with like dumb jokes. And then Buddy's son, Deaton, sent a video of himself dressed up like Baby Yoda from The Mandalorian. And he was clanging bells and cheering on the racers. And even Deaton's dog, Remy, Deaton put some Mickey ears on Remy, and they sent pictures and they cheered on all the racers. So again, Buddy, who is 88, recovering from heart surgery, his route was he just walked up and down the street. He was wearing his little bib, his little racing bib, and two neighbors saw him. And he told the neighbors what he and his fellow racers were doing, and they loved it. And so they started cheering him on. And all in all, each racer walked for about an hour along their own course, laughed the whole time. Deborah said it was so much fun. It brought everybody so much joy. I don't think I've laughed and smiled so much since we've been in quarantine.
Oh.
So after Buddy finished his course and went back to his house, he got to sit and read all the texts and watch all the videos that the cheer squad had sent. And everybody who walked that day, those three friends, Deborah and Buddy and Kimberly from their team, but everybody who walked will get an official medal and a certificate for it. And as my friend Deborah said, no one deserves a medal more than Buddy for the way he's worked on his health since his heart surgery. She went on to say, in a time when everyone is so isolated, it was so great to bring everyone together. People just in their little cohort, people from Georgia, Virginia, North Carolina, and Connecticut were all in on it. For that 1 hour, they were all together supporting each other, laughing and having fun. I love that Deborah caught this spark and ran with it. No yes. pun intended, grandmas. but sparks are everywhere, people. And everywhere. Here's another one. They're everywhere. So I've been working with a lot of people, including students and the teachers who love them, but students who are going to be missing out on their graduations. And I was working with a group that included a graduating college senior named Carly from Utah State University. Holla, Carly.
Holla.
Carly was in a workshop that I was leading, and she was grieving the fact that she wouldn't get to walk in her graduation after working so hard for so long on her vocal performance degree that she wasn't going to get to walk in graduation, as is the case for many.
Yep.
And she felt like the significant rite of passage has been stolen by this pandemic. And I encouraged her first, of course, to feel those feelings, but then to consider what she and her family could do to create their own graduation ceremony and celebration, even in quarantine.
Mm-hmm.
And I was asking her, I was like, as we were talking through this, I was like, what graduation type assets might you have right there in your own quarantine house, Carly? And she was all, well, my mom was saying we have some old graduation robes from my siblings' graduations.
Okay.
And I was like, Carly, you've been holding out on me. You've got the wardrobe. What else are you hiding over there? So we kept like brainstorming and we generated more sparks and came up with some good ideas. And then a few days later, she wrote me this email. Hello, Susan. I have an update for you. We are looking to do my virtual graduation next week. We are putting chairs up in our backyard, bringing out our speakers, putting on pomp and circumstance, and I'm going to walk throughout the yard and my dad will give me a diploma.
Yes.
I will also sing some songs because remember, she's a vocal performance major.
Yes.
And she promised I will 100% send you pictures, signed Carly.
Oh,
so yeah, so I wrote back.
Great.
Carly, hooray for your virtual graduation. Please, please, please tell me that there will be cake. Something that I found so sparkish about your story, Carly, when you look back on your life and you tell the story of this chapter, your graduation story is going to be so, so, so much more interesting and beautiful because it won't be like other people's graduations. It's unique and it will be even more special because you and your family chose to make it so. You continued writing the story and crafted a beautiful ending for yourself. I have no claim to you, but I am so proud of you. Thank you. Thank you. And yes, please be sure to send graduation pictures. Susan.
Yay.
So Carly's graduation.
I'm so excited for her.
I know. I am too. And Carly, look, it's going to be made even more special because we're talking about you on this podcast.
Carly.
Carly's graduation ceremony was, by the time this podcast comes out, was on Sunday. So on behalf of everyone at the Spark File, happy graduation, Carly. And to all the graduates, happy, happy graduation.
Happy
I know that
graduation.
This might seem like a bummer time, that there's a lot of loss, but I also think there's the potential for this time to be really special and significant and memorable, and perhaps even more so because it's happening during a pandemic. So
that's right.
I offer you that. But the loss is real. The grief is real.
Totally.
But then continue the
opportunity.
The story
is real. Yeah.
That's right.
Also the opportunity.
The possibility is real.
And I want to say kudos to Carly's family as well for being willing participants to say, oh, right, let's rally and reimagine.
Let's get out those folding chairs. Amen. I love it. So here's another baby spark. Recently, I was working with a teacher, again, in another state. She has a 90-year-old mother sheltering with her, and they love movie theater popcorn as much as I love movie theater popcorn. And they found a place where they can get it to go. So I was like, I would like to know more about that. I dug a little deeper. I found an article on Variety.com. Rebecca Rubin wrote about a cinema owner in Virginia named Mark O'Meara. This is from her article. With social distancing in place and non-essential businesses closed for now, cinemas have been hit hard. Essentially, all cinemas in the U.S. were forced to close, causing an estimated 150,000 workers to be furloughed or let go entirely. Cinema owner Mark O'Meara said, "It's horrible. All my life, I've had all kinds of tragedies, but I've never had a problem missing a meal or sleeping. This has been bugging me. I've been waking up in the middle of the night. As a 67-year-old, you're supposed to get sleep, but I haven't been able to." But Mark O'Meara caught a good spark. Since he couldn't sell movie tickets, he took inspiration from a nearby McDonald's that was offering only takeout, and he started to sell curbside concessions, selling tubs of popcorn for $3. And all of this is in an effort. This makes me want to cry. Ugh. All of this is in an effort to continue paying employees.
Oh.
So after rolling out the promotion in mid-March, O'Meara made $25 in 45 minutes, and he's currently selling roughly $300 to $400 worth of product a day outside of his business. He said, "I'll do what I can to get these kids paid." Someone got her paycheck. I was watching her. She took out her calculator and said, "Yes, I can pay the rent."
Oh.
That's what it's all about. Okay, this makes me emotional. It's all about paying those people.
It is, and it's about thinking creatively on, all right, so what do we have? What can we do? And you know, Mark reimagined it.
How can we keep each other afloat?
Oh my God, that really got me. You really find like the business owners, like there's a real distinct clarity on those business owners that are like, what can I do to keep my employees paid or to take care of my employees in some way during this?
Yeah.
And those, I think I just want those companies to rise to the top. I want those, you know, if we could all like be aware of them so we can like support their efforts in some way.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely.
I'd buy some movie popcorn. I would.
Girl, you know, I would, because I have to say, I love movie popcorn. Ugh. I love popcorn. I love movie theater popcorn. And if you are a lover of the taste and smell of it, movie theater popcorn really does give you a wonderful feeling, because we usually get it when we're like nestling into our chair to watch a movie. And if you're a movie lover, So it gives me this feeling when I smell it and when I taste it, that life is good and I'm in for a treat. And in times like these, I feel like that really matters.
Yep.
So I checked there. I didn't find a local cinema selling it in my area, but I did figure out how to make great popcorn at home. And thanks to my sister, Julie, the good people of the United States Postal Service and FedEx and UPS, I now have this fantastic Amish popcorn, a Whirly Pop, some weird orange powdered popcorn seasoning that my sister found at a restaurant supply store that makes the popcorn taste like movie theater popcorn. And I'm telling you, Camian, it's a small thing, but it makes watching Netflix more special, or make like you choose a movie together and it makes watching it more special. This reminds me of a tiny little side spark. This spark is just like a free association spark, but this is a tiny little side spark. You and I were having an online meeting with a client, a friend of the podcast, James. And James has been
working
these very long days trying to figure out how to navigate and lead through these pandemic times. And I think he's doing an amazing job.
Oh yeah.
So during our call, we're having this call, and this is at the end of a long, you know, he's just like, but in the middle of this long day, like just like Zoom conference after Zoom conference, his wife, Lori, off screen, brought him this little bowl of popcorn because he loves popcorn. And I thought, that is so kind and so loving. And it's exactly what I'm talking about. Whether you're doing it, something you do, a kindness you do for yourself or for someone else, just a little gesture that disrupts the day or the work and brings somebody a little piece of uplift. So good job, Lori. Good job, James.
Lori.
Good job, popcorn.
That's so special. And I think in this time we are, you know, our expectations are being reset in a way that a small gesture can feel so enormous and so incredible that, you know, a little bowl of popcorn. It's so
little
thoughtful.
Bowl of popcorn. Mm-hmm. That's right.
Love it. I love it.
Speaking of such things, sparks and treats and sparky treats.
Yeah.
My husband was mentioning how much he used to love this German chocolate cake recipe that his mom used to make. And I heard it and I got the spark and I contacted his mother, my mother-in-law, who I love. And I got her to send me the recipe for this icing. And as a surprise, I didn't make a big deal about it, but I got the ingredients from Amazon and I made him that German chocolate cake almost from scratch. I used a gluten-free box cake mix, which was excellent, I have to say. But it was a really special surprise that I had just paid attention when he said he had recollected that he loved it.
Uh-huh.
And then I'd taken the time to get the recipe from her. And then I actually made it. It was really special.
So that is sweet.
That's a thing that if you're fortunate enough to have like mothers and mother-in-laws and people still alive who can like share recipes with you.
Yeah.
This is a great time for that.
So sweet. So incredible. I love that he must have just been out of his mind with appreciation and
it turned out pretty great. The cake turned out great and his response to it was great. But what else can you do to make these cue times, which can blend into one another these days, can just be sort of a bledge. But there are ways to make them special and memorable. And how can you do it on a serious budget? Mm-hmm. Because many of us are rocking a serious budget. How about a yes day? I saw this on HuffPost.com in an article by Caroline Bologna, and I really like the idea of this. Whether you're quarantining by yourself or with others, can you grant yourself a yes day? Ice cream for breakfast? Sure.
Yes.
Popcorn for lunch? Why not?
Yes.
I get to pick the movie? Sounds awesome. I get to watch the same movie 2 times in a row? Yes, queen.
Oh, that's lovely.
Whether you're a kid or an adult, I can imagine that getting to have a yes day every once in a while could be pretty fun. And it could be a day where I'm like, okay, Nathan, this is your yes day. And if he's like, I would love it if you would help me in the garage. And I'd be like, yes.
Yes.
Or I would love it if you would make that thing for dinner. Yes. Like, you can imagine like how... I don't know. That doesn't have to cost any money.
I think I read something about Jennifer Garner doing that for her kids, maybe on their birthday. But it also, you know, the caveat was like, it's not like, can I have a new iPhone? Can I, you know, it wasn't about like, can you buy me things? But it was, can we play this? Can we do this together? Can we go for a walk? Will you, you know, run around with me? Whatever. And she is like, and I have to say yes. I say yes to all of it.
Oh my God, I love it.
Just such a great idea.
I love it.
It's really, really sweet. But to do it for yourself, like, it's wonderful if you have a partner and you can do it for each other. But you don't have to. You could do it for you.
You don't have to. You could do it for you. You could do it for you. If you're like, I don't want to, you know, do I have to take a shower? No. I mean, do I get to not take a shower?
Yes.
Like, whatever you want to do. Or can I take a bath? Yes. Can I cut out of work early? Yes. Can I, like, there's so many.
So good.
Can I buy that little like treat at the bodega? Yes.
Yes.
All of it. So I put a little call out on social media and I just wrote, seeking inspiration. What are you doing to make your quarantine fun, special, or tolerable? What is brightening your days? And I just want to share some of the things that came back, which I love. I'm not sure how to pronounce the name. Finny.Alilia, maybe, says, I've been going on a lot of walks with my mom. I love that. Mm-hmm. Doesn't cost anything. You can, if you need to, you can still socially distance, but you get that quality time. Yep. If you're lucky enough to have your mom near you and alive, I love that. Mayorholm Wood 16 wrote, I've been doing a 2-person production of Les Mis with my sister. Uh-huh. Just now we're singing it and then we're going to film it. And it's a great distraction from what's happening in the world. And I was like, yes, Mayorholm Wood 16.
Wow.
Love it. Love it. Here's an amazing one. I accidentally became a beekeeper. They swarmed me 4 times. I took the hint. Now reading obsessively about these creatures. If you want to read about them, you'll surely find inspiration. Come on. That is phenomenal.
Wow. Wow.
Haley214 says, using what I have in my craft room to be creative. I've been using playbills to make paper flowers and jewelry. Both new things for me. Yes, Haley214.
Fantastic.
Love it. Love it. Oh, this is a good one. Everything Bagel with Cream Cheese said, finding something to look forward to every single day. Tonight, I am in a cook-off with friends. More of a food style competition as the winner is determined by their final photo submission. I was just like, these are amazing.
That's amazing. Incredible. People are so creative.
Trees Star Scar says, I've been stuck in bed with the virus for 2 weeks. So finding that place has been hard. That makes sense to me. I feel like if your health has been compromised and challenging, it would be very hard to have the capacity to find pockets of inspiration. But Trees.Stars.Scars says, I've spent a lot of time watching things that inspire me, like RuPaul's Drag Race and shows about art history. Yes, me too. It's encouraged me to pull out my sketchbook when I have the energy. I've also been keeping a daily journal about how this experience has been almost to the other side of being sick, I hope. I love that because this is such a historically significant time. That is going to be legacy. That journal work and that sketchbook is going to be legacy. So I am just even saying this right now, and I just want to say back to you, trees.stars.scars, I hope that you feel better and better and stronger with each passing day. And we are so proud of you for like finding the time, the capacity to do things that are refilling your spark file and also some gentle, gentle self-expression. So proud of you. I just got whipped up for a second.
So good. I mean, you will not regret having that catalog, that book of experiences, you know, to reflect back on get on the other side of this. Yeah.
Amazing. That's incredible. Just amazing. Like so many things, the idea of making even an average day a little bit creative and a little special is something I think I got from my mom. My mom is always looking for sparks, including sparks that provide comfort and sparks that make memories. And, Nancy, you know, she's always a girl on a budget, so none of it is ever super high ticket. But one example is many years ago, I was visiting my parents' house and I was laying outside on a blanket on the lawn. And my mom was just puttering around doing chores and she buzzed by the blanket and she put two kittens on the blanket, just little kittens that had been born recently. And it was such a small thing, but it made that moment, which might've just passed on out of my memory and into history. It made it so special and so memorable. And it's exactly what I'm talking about here. Sometimes when life is mundane or challenging, or you need a little lift, figure out how you can put a couple of kittens on your blanket or somebody else's.
Oh,
and that is my spark. Kittens on a blanket.
Kittens on a blanket. So sweet and so good and chock full of great ideas for everyone who's trying to find a little spark in this crazy time.
Trying to find their kittens on a blanket.
So kittens on a blanket.
Sweet. Kittens on a blanket. I've also had that was a nice harmony cams. I've been working with a vocal coach. just a real covered sound.
That's
really kittens
good.
On a blanket. I guess that's it. Is that it? I think that's it.
Actually, in that, can I say a kittens on a blanket thing? I want to just give some props to Wesley Day.
Yes, kittens on a blanket.
I have a friend who had written a new play, Manny, Manny Gracious,
Manny
you know.
Gracious, yes.
And,
this is so kittens on a blanket.
It's so kittens on a blanket. I loved it so much. And I was working all day right up to the moment when the play was going to start. So Wes was like, I'll get us ready.
Like a virtual reading, right? Virtual reading?
Mm-hmm. It was a virtual reading. But it was so top-notch. Like you arrived in the virtual space and it was like lobby music and visual of the lobby.
That's what I'm
talking
about.
Doors aren't open yet. Yeah.
Oh, I love that.
It was so cool. But what Wes did... So he knew I was going to be working right up till, you know, moments before. And he remembered we had some popcorn. We had some, so speaking of popcorn, it was like kettle corn, but, you know, not exactly movie popcorn, but it was still delicious.
Oh, kettle corn. Bonus points for kettle corn.
Honestly, bonus points all around because he set up two chairs outside. The computer on a little table in front of us had our drinks and popcorn ready.
Oh, great.
And I just was like, are we ready? I'm thinking like we're going to go to the living room and sit and watch. And he's like, movie theater is right this way. Or the theater was right this way. And so we sat outside and watched Manny's play, which was wonderful. And just enjoyed, you know, a really special like – outdoor theater experience.
This is exactly what I'm talking about. This is something you will never forget. Mm-mm. This is hashtag kittens on a blanket.
Kittens on a blanket.
It's just taking that little, like, what did that take him to do? Like 7 minutes to set that up?
Sure, yeah.
Taking, when you have them, we don't always have the 7 minutes, but when you have mm-hmm. the time and when you have a little skosh of energy, just catching a little spark, putting a kitten on a blanket and making it a little bit more special. That
I
is
love it.
Fantastic. And I it also sparks it. Me because when the weather is a little bit warmer, something that we like to do is instead of watching the movie indoors, just projecting it on the side of the house
yes.
and making a drive-in movie outside.
It's one of my favorite things to do. I love that so much.
Kittens on a blanket. I guess that's it. We hope that this put another bunch of sparks in your file. Listen to us when we tell you if there is a spark you'd like us to explore, or if you've taken a spark and fanned it into a creative flame and you'd like to share that, email us at thesparkfile@gmail.com or submit it through our website, thesparkfile.com. Y'all, mailbags, mailbags.
Mailbags.
We've got a mailbag episode coming up.
Y'all,
send
mailbags.
Send us some sparks.
Send us some sparks. And you can even send us some feedback if you have some, but you know the price of admission. First, you have to share a creative risk that you have taken recently.
Oh, also follow us on social media at The Spark File, and be sure to subscribe to this podcast wherever you get your podcasts. Subscribe, rate, 5-star review it. If you like this podcast, we hope that you'll share it with people that you loved. And if you didn't like it, it's okay, but we're curious. What do you love? Would we like it too? Will you let us know? Ha ha ha, we tricked you into sending us sparks. Ha ha ha.
Ha, ha, ha. If something tickles your fancy and gets your creative juices flowing, we are writing you a forever permission slip to make that thing that has been knocking at your door. It's your turn to take a spark and fan it into a flame.
You got to collage it. You got to decoupage it. You got to make an artsy craft, then be sure to Mod Podge it.
You got to take it
and make it.
Make it.
Bye. How you feeling now, Cams? You sound like a different person.
You know, I just talked my way through it. Went straight through
there
it.
There you go.
On the other side now.
I Whee. Love it.
Whee!
Whee!
Kittens on a blanket.
Kittens on a blanket.
Kittens on a blanket.
Bump.
When I bump into something that inspires me, I dump it in my spark file. Could be something that I want to make or how I want to be. I pump it in my spark file. I jump into my spark file. Let's open up the spark file.
Hi friends, Susan Blackwell from the Spark File here to let you know that the doors are open for the Spark File Illume, a 9-month group creativity coaching mastermind that invites you to be the chief creative officer and chief marketing officer of your creativity. But what does that mean? That means in 9 months in Illume, you will clarify and advance your big creative goals and learn how to effectively share your work with the world. Now, if you're listening to this and you're an experienced creative or an accomplished professional who seeks a space where it is safe to attempt something you've never tried before, or complete a big creative project, or take your work to the next level, and acquire the skills needed to share your creative work with the world, Illume might be right for you. We are calling in emotionally intelligent, high-functioning creatives who are ready to level up. You can find out more by going to thesparkfile.com/Illume, but do it now to find out if Illume is right for you and to save with early bird discounts. That's thesparkfile.com/Illume. Take a leap, take a risk, go to thesparkfile.com/Illume and join us for Illume.